Hi, the title of my talk is Evolutionary Explanation of Psychopaths. In my talk, I'll explain why psychopaths exist from an evolutionary point of view. These are the contents of my presentation. I will exhibit the characteristics of psychopaths. I'll explain the cheater hypothesis proposed by Frank and Mealy to explain the existence of psychopaths. I'll propose my own hypothesis, which I call brutality hypothesis. Finally, I'll predict the psychopaths will eventually die out in the future. My presentation illustrates how biology, psychology, philosophy, and archaeology can work together to make a contribution to criminology. I hope you enjoy my talk. These are the characteristics of psychopaths. They are the most brutal people, and they kill people for fun. And when they kill people, they don't feel empathetic pain. They don't feel remorseful about what they have done. And they don't discard the murder weapons they once used. They stash them away and sometimes pull them out to take a look at them and enjoy the good old memories. And they are experts in concealing their brutality. They are charming fathers at home, and nice neighbors in their community, and intelligent professionals at work. People around them are shocked when their inner trait is disclosed to the world. In short, psychopaths are ultimate killing machines. And the question is, why do they exist? You know, evolutionary theory is the paradigm for contemporary biology and psychology. That means psychologists and biologists are doing what they are doing under the framework of evolutionary theory. And the biologists and psychologists don't know what they are doing if they reject evolutionary theory. And this is important. Every human behavior should make sense in the light of evolution. And the problem is, psychopaths' behavior doesn't seem to make sense from the evolutionary point of view. Now, after all, if you habitually kill others for fun, chances are that you will be caught and punished by others. So psychopaths seem to have a lower chance to survive and reproduce than non-psychopaths. So they should have perished a long time ago. And question is, why do they exist? How can evolutionary theory account for the existence of psychopaths? And this is the question I'm trying to answer today. And there are researchers in the literature who are interested in that question too. Frank and Mealy proposed what might be called the cheater hypothesis to explain the existence of psychopaths. According to the cheater hypothesis, psychopaths were naturally selected like other cheaters in nature. A paradigm example of a cheater in nature is cuckoos. Cuckoos deceive other birds. They lay their eggs on altruistic birds, and altruistic birds rear cuckoo's offspring. Similarly, psychopaths deceive other people. They appear to be harmless and innocent to their family members, to their neighbors, and to their co-workers. And the number of cuckoos is small compared to the number of other birds. If there are too many cuckoos in nature, both cuckoos and altruistic birds will die out. So the number of cuckoos should be kept below a certain threshold. And the number of psychopaths is also small compared to that of non-psychopaths. According to Glenn et al., approximately 1% of the general population is thought to be psychopaths. In short, according to the cheater hypothesis, psychopaths are kind of cheaters. Cheater hypothesis is illuminating, but it has a shortcoming. It does not capture the most salient characteristic of psychopaths, namely brutality. The cheater hypothesis doesn't explain how brutality raised the fitness level of psychopaths in the past. So here comes another hypothesis, which I call the brutality hypothesis. Imagine that there was a group of individuals in the distant past. They are our ancestors, but they are not necessarily humans. They might be hominids, they might be merely mammals. And that group was composed of both brutal and meek individuals. Let's call that group Group 1. And Group 1 lived in a certain region. And unfortunately, a natural disaster, for example, drought, occurred in that region. So they moved to another place, a temperate region. And unfortunately, there was already another group of individuals. And that group was composed of only meek individuals. They were all nice, gentle, and mild. Let's call that group Group 2. And Group 1 formed an army to attack Group 2. And actually, the army attacked Group 2. And when the army attacked Group 2, the soldiers used not modern weapons such as missiles and bombs, but ancient weapons such as tooth and claw, or at best, sticks and stones. There is an important difference between ancient weapons and modern weapons. The difference is that you have to be extremely brutal to kill your enemies with the ancient weapons. You have to see your enemy's blood. You have to hit your enemies again and again until they die. But when you use modern weapons, you don't have to be that brutal to kill your enemies. You only need to press a button from a distance to kill your enemies. In any event, Group 2, all the members of Group 2 died. Recall that Group 1 was composed of both brutal individuals and meek individuals. Naturally, its army was also comprised of brutal soldiers and meek soldiers. And brutal soldiers enjoyed killing members of Group 2. After the war, they formed families, and they acted like good fathers at home. In contrast, meek soldiers did not enjoy killing the members of Group 2. They experienced empathetic pain. After the war, they suffered from guilt feelings and bad dreams. They could not get the horrible memories off their minds. They couldn't get married. They could not form families of their own. Some of them committed suicide. In short, the brutal soldiers were less humane. They were less humane because they were cruel. The brutal soldiers were less humane, but more professional than the meek soldiers. The story I just provided is purely speculative. But it illustrates how cruel individuals were more successful than mild individuals in the distant past, in desperate circumstances where there were not enough natural resources to sustain the entire population. Thus, the brutality had an adaptive value. It raised the fitness level of certain individuals. And brutality was transmitted from generation to generation down to the present day. That's why there are psychopaths today. The brutality hypothesis I just explained receives support from the history of violence. Steven Pinker, a psychology professor at Harvard University, published an interesting book in 2011. In the book, he claims that in the Paleolithic era, 15% of human beings were killed by other human beings, whereas in the 20th century, only 3% of human beings were killed by other human beings. According to Pinker, the murder rate dropped significantly because right after the Paleolithic era, our ancestors established governments and systematically punished criminals. These figures, 15% and 3%, are interesting to me because they indicate that the past environment our ancestors lived in was much bloodier than the present environment. Steven Pinker's observation of the history of violence is congruent with Thomas Hobbes' political philosophy. Thomas Hobbes was an English philosopher in the 17th century. He famously claimed that if there were no government, there would be a war of all against all. This is a very famous phrase, war of all against all. Now, for Hobbes, human beings are selfish by nature. So they will do whatever they can to preserve themselves. For example, I may take your possessions, your wife, even your body, simply because they come in handy to satisfy my desire. But I actually don't do those things because if I do, my government will punish me. In any event, both Pinker and Hobbes, the great thinkers, would agree with me that our ancestors were brutal. I think psychopaths will ultimately perish in the future. Why do I think so? Well, because as Pinker observes, violence has been declining thanks to the government efforts to punish criminals. So there will be less violence in the future than in the present. And there will be more role to play. Government will play more role in the future than in the present. Secondly, less brutality is required to conduct warfare in modern times. As I said earlier, you only need to press a button to kill your enemies these days. So, there will be fewer opportunities for psychopaths to exercise their abilities. This is the conclusion of my talk. Evolutionary theory can account for the existence of psychopaths, despite the initial appearance to the contrary. Psychopaths are the legacy of British evolutionary history that our ancestors went through. That's it for my talk. I hope you enjoyed it. I skipped many important details due to lack of time and for the sake of brevity. If you are interested in an evolutionary explanation of psychopaths, you may want to take a look at my paper, Evolutionary Explanation of Psychopaths. It'll soon be published in Aggression and Violent Behavior, an SSCI journal. Thank you for the attention.